At WWDC last week, Apple announced the latest version of macOS, Catalina, and I'm here to show you some of the cool new features that it will bring when it comes out later this fall. This video is sponsored by AdGuard for iOS and desktop. Block ads, speed up web pages, get rid of junk, and more. Try it out today with the link below for free. If you ask me, the headlining feature of both iPadOS 13 and macOS Catalina is a new utility called Sidecar. Now you will need an iPad with an A8 chip or later, and you will need a MacBook of basically, or an iMac of basically 2015 era or later. Both devices need the ability to encode and decode HEVC on the ASIC or SoC. So that's why they need newer hardware. Although if you do have an old Mac, there is a workaround. You can input this terminal command and get it to work, although your reliability is not quite as good. It's not as good of an experience, but it does work. Now again, I said you can use any iPad with an A8 or later, but where this really comes in clutch is if you have an Apple Pencil. Because if I extend the display, it appears as an AirPlay device on my laptop. I just press iPad Pro, and suddenly, it makes my iPad a secondary display. And I can drag windows over here just like I would a secondary monitor. I have it set up right to left right now, but see that? And you can tell that the latency is really, really good. But what you can also do is mirror the display. And it makes your main Mac look a little bit funny, admittedly, but what it allows you to do is basically have your entire Mac here on your iPad. And again, latency is excellent. You can control this with the touchpad if you want, or you can control it with the Apple Pencil. Now, it doesn't support touch input, so if you touch stuff, it will not work. The cynic in me believes it's because Apple wants you to buy a $130 Apple Pencil and a new iPad Pro. Realistically, it's probably because they haven't really optimized macOS for these smaller displays. So the touch targets are very small and your fat fingers may not be able to do that. If you do have an iPad, however, you can emulate the touch bar. So down here, you'll notice that the touch bar and all the touch bar controls appear. So I can go backwards, I can go forwards, and this emulates a touch bar even if you don't have a touch bar enabled Mac. But beyond that, and this can all be touched, but beyond that, basically you need an Apple Pencil. So you can modify any of these keys with modifier keys. You also have a pop-up keyboard. This is all enabled on all the iPads, but the Apple Pencil is where this thing really shines. And why I say that, beyond being able to control the user interface, is that there is multi-touch support on the iPad Pro, so you can use two fingers to scroll like you would normally do. You can also pinch to zoom if you're in Safari on live view content. So let's go here, and then I can pinch and zoom in and out. So that works really, really well. It feels basically native like an iPad. And what you can also do is use applications that are optimized for the Apple Pencil, which there are not very many right now, but there is going to become an increasing number. So to give you just a demonstration, we're gonna go to the Finder here, then we're gonna go into my Downloads folder, and we are going to find this DNG RAW file, and we're going to open it in an application which I have not purchased called Affinity. So we're gonna enter the trial mode here. And Affinity is already optimized for Apple Pencil. So again, you can zoom in, you can zoom out, you can kinda go up, scroll around, two-finger scroll around, maybe. There you go. And it works pretty well. What you can also do is utilize the pencil to do pencil style gestures. So let's say I want to, I don't know, I like the look of this little yellow tree right here. Come on. This little yellow tree. So I am going to, first of all, develop this photo as a RAW file. And then I'm going to do basic, just the auto contrast and color. So that makes it look much better already. And then what I'm going to do is use my blemish removal tool. I can hold down a modifier key with this little option button over here. I can copy this area, and then I can go in and just draw a new tree wherever I want. And since it supports Apple Pencil, it works super easily. So I can draw little yellow trees wherever I want. In areas like this, this becomes really, really, really cool. It's already supported natively in preview, and it uses the same touch sensitivity that you have on your Apple Pencil on your iPad. So what I view it to be is kind of a Wacom killer. It's, you know, those drawing tablets that artists use. Now you have full integration with Illustrator and all of the big drawing applications, and you know, you just do it right on an iPad. There's no latency issues. The color actually looks really, really close on both of my displays. It works super seamlessly, and it's really cool to have macOS on an iPad, even if macOS isn't really on an iPad. Rest in peace, iTunes, you colossal sack of crap. Apple finally came to their senses, and they got rid of iTunes, which has become bloated over years and years and years. And there are now three separate, distinct, and simpler apps. The most obvious successor to iTunes, what I estimate to be using the iTunes framework, is called Music. Here you will find your Apple Music library, your local music as well, and actually when you plug in an iOS device, it still syncs through this application. So it's basically just a really stripped down, simple version of iTunes. But most of iTunes' features, like sorting capabilities and playlists and all that stuff, remains available. It's just simpler. You can tell I haven't really purchased anything on iTunes since roughly 2007, since Avril Lavigne is at the top of my list, but she's still good. And let's say you want to watch some TV shows and movies. Rather than going to iTunes, there is now a new application called AppleTV. So all of your iTunes purchases will appear in this player. And when the Apple streaming service becomes available this fall, you'll access all of that content through here as well. And then the last application is the Podcasts app. This, again, used to be part of iTunes way back in the day when you could actually sync your podcast to your iPod every week. And now you just access them through here. Now, the interesting thing about the podcast app is that it is a Catalyst app. And really, I think this project speaks volumes. Catalyst will allow app developers, iOS app developers, to easily port their applications to macOS. They'll still generally look and feel like a Mac app, but they'll be running and sharing most of the same code base as iOS. So you're going to see a huge influx of quality applications for the Mac that previously couldn't justify a dedicated Mac version, but now that making a Mac version is easier, we're going to start to see them. And that's cool. I, for one, welcome them. Apple's improved a lot. macOS Mojave that came out last year, there were a couple of applications that were Catalyst apps. The Home app, which was pretty crappy. The Stocks app, which was not good. And the Voice Memos app, which also was not good. I was worried about Project Catalyst. But the podcast app, for all intents and purposes, I mean, it functions pretty much like, honestly, like the Apple Music app, which is based on an iTunes framework. So I'm excited to see what app developers can do with Catalyst, and hopefully we're going to see a lot of good new applications this fall. Stay tuned for some videos on that. The Notes app on iOS 13 and iPadOS 13 have pretty big upgrades. Now on macOS, those updates are a little bit more minor, but there are some new cool features that I'd like to show you. For one, edit permissions are drastically different. So you used to be able to, you've always been able to share a note with someone, but now you can share an entire folder. So if there's a lot of information that you want to share, you run an organization or family, you can do that. Another thing that you can do, and this is one I'm really excited about, is you can restrict edit permissions to view only. So you've always been able to share a note, but whoever the note was shared with could modify and change it. And now you can make it so that they can only view the note so long as they have permissions. And then of course, as you've always been able to do, you can retract those permissions at any time and that note will leave that individual's device. Couple other minor features that are really pretty handy. The checklist functionality can now be reorganized by dragging them. So if we did, I don't know, 1, 2, 3, we can take these bullet points and you just drag them around. This is way nice, way better than having to copy and paste and all that other stuff. You can still check them off and you can move them down into different sections. You can actually even move them between different checklists, which is really pretty awesome. So that's a nice feature that you can implement. There's also an easier way to view it. You can view all of your notes in a grid list, in a grid rather than a list, which can be good if you have a lot of notes and you're looking for something visual. But the search functionality is a lot more powerful because since iOS is a thing and since iPad is a thing where a lot of notes are handwritten, you can now use optical character recognition or OCR to search any handwritten text or scanned documents, which is really, really pretty awesome. And that's about it for notes. Not big changes, but nice, welcome ones. There was also a huge update to the Reminders app on both iOS and macOS. And I'll be honest, I don't use Reminders, so I can't really give you a good rundown of what's different. But trust me, if you're a Reminders user, you're gonna like it, I guess. System preferences got a massive overhaul in macOS. Not only did everything get basically reorganized to a more sensical layout, but the new Apple account functionality, which I'm not going to show you because of kind of private information, is really handy. It allows you to see all of your devices, where they're located, the serial numbers, what information you're sharing with Apple and what you're not. It's just a very simple, transparent way to find everything. Your iTunes history, it's awesome. Not iTunes history. What are they going to call it now? I don't know. Okay, but what a big new feature is screen time. Screen time is not new to iOS. It's been on there for a couple of years. But the thing I like about macOS, and it's the same on iOS 13, is that you're allowed to really get into some pretty specific details. And they've kind of merged the parental controls panel with this same category. So not only can you do the same stuff you've always been able to do, view notifications, what apps are showing you notifications, identify usage, how long you've been using them, as well as how many times you've picked up or turned on your device. But it also allows you to set downtime where the computer basically shuts itself off. And you can also set individual per app limits on macOS. And they don't have to be App Store apps. They can be any app on macOS, which is really pretty handy. You guys also have a list of apps that are always allowed and don't restrict themselves based on downtime or app limits. But the communications tab and the content and privacy tabs are pretty nice because you can see this little slider right here. It just says Quinn Nelson because I'm the only one on, I don't have an iCloud family plan. But if I did, you can restrict telephone communications, contact communications, and kind of web usage from your children's or your spouse's, from your children's devices directly from your computer without having to get theirs and do it from your phone. It's just really nice that all the platforms are now kind of agnostic and they work nicely with one another. So it's good to see screen time on macOS because a lot of people, like me, use Twitter too much during the day. I need to restrict usage. Find Friends and Find My iPhone have long been very popular applications for iOS. But on the Mac, you had to visit iCloud through a web browser. It wasn't elegant. It didn't work well. Well, now on both iOS and macOS, there's just a single app. It's called Find My whatever you want. If you enter the application, and I'm betting this is a Catalyst app, you can find all of your friends in the People tab. And then if you go to the Devices tab, it shows you where all of your devices are located. Now, a new feature about this Find My application that is really, really cool that they didn't really touch on all that much is that it uses your Bluetooth connection. So let's say Snazzy's iMac Pro 2, which cannot be found, is stolen or lost. Well, that's not a good example because that one has to be plugged in. Let's say my MacBook gets stolen or lost. Well, I can, as I've always been able to do, mark the device as lost. And then I can also press the Notify Me button. And what happens is that the device, even though it's not connected to a Wi-Fi network, will use Bluetooth. And any other Apple devices that are in the proximity area, other Apple users, so let's say someone steals your laptop and they own an iPhone, the thief's own iPhone will ping you telling you that they found your device and this is where. It's really, really cool because it kind of uses this crowd sharing mentality that makes a lot of those tile, little things cool. And it's pretty great to be able to find your device even if it doesn't have a network connection via Bluetooth and crowdsourcing. So pretty cool. Okay, this last feature isn't going to get that much usage by most people, but I feel like I have to talk about it because of how insanely cool and powerful it is. It's a new accessibility feature intended for those with limited mobility. It can be found inside of accessibility, then in the subsection called dictation, and then if you enable voice control. Now, voice control for Apple fans who've been around the block know that that's not a new tool. It was actually around before Siri was a thing. You could give it very rudimentary commands and your iPhone would sometimes do what you wanted. Well, it's back in macOS Catalina and iOS 13, and it works extremely well. If you enable it, it allows you to control your computer only using your voice. And there are hundreds of commands. I don't know them, but you can see the little microphone in the bottom right hears me, and I can start to issue it commands. Open Safari. Click Snazzy Labs. Scroll down. Scroll down. New tab. Search for Mr. Mobile YouTube. Search Mr. Bubble, so it's not perfect. It's pretty good. Show numbers. Click 28. Quit Safari. Open Text Edit. Click New Document. This is going to be a good day. Replace day with life. Correct going. 2. Apostrophe. Move to end of sentence. Period. Select all. Italicize that. Isn't that freaking cool? So it doesn't do everything perfectly yet, but it has a lot of capability, a surprising amount, and it does a really, really good job. I'm just excited to see Apple and other companies really pushing forward accessibility options for those who need them. This video is sponsored by AdGuard. If you're an iOS or Android user, you've no doubt heard of it. You might even use it. It's the best ad and contact blocker for iOS, and I've been using it for years. What you may not know is that they have an inexpensive premium plan with a ton of cool features. AdGuard blocks ads before they load, saving your data and increasing your page load speed. It's excellent at preventing malware on desktop machines and allows for in-app filtering as well on both macOS and Windows. On desktop computers, it includes powerful parental controls and disables tracking pixels. All of those features are already worth the insanely low price of AdGuard, but if you visit my link in the video description and use my coupon code at checkout, you can save an additional 30%. Well, folks, that's all for me. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, you know what to do. If you didn't, well, that other button seems to work okay too. Get subscribed for more awesome tech videos like these, but most importantly, and as always, stay snazzy.